Thank you so much. What an honor to be here to help you celebrate the 10th anniversary of this great institution. It's also an honor for me to serve on the Board of Trustees with my friends on the board, my new friends on the faculty. I admire so much what's going on here. My only wish is that I had been a student here myself, and I have certain desires for my own children who are coming on the age of college. Who knows, maybe they'll join some of you. I've had an unusual path as a scholar, as you've heard. I mean, I started out as a French horn player. Later, I was a college professor. And when I was teaching at Syracuse University, teaching economics at Syracuse University, one of my colleagues, who was not an economist, at one point we were having lunch, and he complained about my work. He said, "You know the problem with you and the other economists?" And I said, "No, tell me." I mean, I didn't want to know, but he said, "You don't really know what makes people tick." And I said, "What are you talking about?" He said, "I'll tell you what, here's a story that shows what's wrong with people like you." He said, "There are three old friends who golf together every Saturday morning." Okay, now, he's lost me because I've never really golfed, but I listened along. Three old friends who golf every Saturday morning. One is a priest, one's a psychologist, and one's a free market economist, he told me, just like you. I said, "Okay, I'm with you." He said, "Well, one beautiful August morning, they got out first thing in the morning, 7:30 in the morning. It was gorgeous. They couldn't wait to play. And the first thing that happens is they got stuck behind the slowest twosome that they ever encountered. The two golfers in front of them were going so slowly that they could barely play. When they were on the green, it took four shots to get it into the hole. It took 5 minutes to select a club, even though they had a caddy. So it should have been going faster, but it was going slower. Now, three holes went by, and finally, they were losing their patience, and they started to make remarks. The priest said, "I pray I never get stuck behind a twosome this slow ever again." Nothing. Two more holes go by, and so finally they go marching up to the twosome. They actually talk to the caddy, and they say, "Listen, this is intolerable. You got to let us play through." The caddy says, "Fine, that, of course you can play through. But do you realize how rude you've been? Do you know who these two guys are?" I say, "No. Who are they?" He says, "Well, you remember last year when the town orphanage burned down?" "Yeah." "You remember those two firefighters who pulled all the orphans out of the blaze, but in the process, they lost their sight in the accident?" The three friends say, "You're kidding me. It's not..." He says, "Yeah, it's the two firefighters. It's the heroes. Golfing was their passion. Obviously, it takes a little longer now, but maybe a little respect." Now, the three friends are mortified, as any of us would be. And the psychologist says, "You know, I'm going to take this as an opportunity to become a better professional. I've dedicated my life to helping people, and now I do this. So calloused, so insensitive. I'm going to remember this and be a better psychologist." The priest says, "That's a good point. Right at this moment, I have a contrite heart, and I thank the Lord for that." The free market economist thinks about it for a minute, and he says, "You know, it would be more economically efficient if they played at night." So I said to my friend, "I take your point. What do people care about? What do you think really makes them tick?" And he says, I got an idea for you. Go ask 10 people. Just go ask 10 people. I said, "Fine." So I did it. I asked 10 people. They all give me the same answer. And it's the same answer you'd give me. The same answer I'd give, quite frankly. We just want to be happy. Now, we should probably say we just want to be holy. But what we always say is we just want to be happy. So I started studying the subject of happiness. As an economist, I turned all of my resources on the subject of happiness. And I'm going to tell you today what I learned. And I'm going to start by telling you the most basic answer, which is, who's happy? Okay? What percentage of people are happy? Now, it's really easy to measure, it turns out. You think you'd have to put people in functional MRI machines or do brain scans or something. Uh-uh. Psychologists have found in 40 years of research that it's shockingly easy to figure out who's happy. You take large samples of people, ask them questions that are pretty broad, not about how happy you are at this moment, but rather all things considered in your life, how happy are you in this period of your life? And then you ask them this anonymously so they're not feeling pressured to give the right answer around loved ones. And when you do this, you get some pretty reasonable and pretty accurate answers. So let me ask you, on a scale of 1 to 7, where 1 is miserable and 7 is the happiest person you've ever met, what's your number? I bet you know it. I bet you got the number in your head right now. Right? I'm not going to ask you to tell me. What do Americans say? 1 in 2, not very happy. 10 to 15% of the population. 3, 4, and 5, pretty happy. 56% of the population. The remaining third are very happy, 6s and 7s. Count yourself lucky if you're in the top third. And this has been stable for decade after decade. People have been very happy in the United States by about a third of the population for a long time, and it doesn't matter who's president, and it doesn't matter what the economy is doing very much. It doesn't really matter what's going on. We're very stable in our happiness, which is kind of an interesting thing. And this leads actually to a much more interesting question, and that's what I want to spend my time on today, which is what causes human happiness? What do we know about what causes happiness? And the answer is 3 things. Okay? I know the title of my speech makes it sound like I'm going to say 4 things, and I will get to that. But basically, it's 3 things. It's your genes, it's big events in your life, and it's your lifestyle. It's the stuff that you choose. So I'm going to tell you about each one of these things and how you can use it. And if you don't actually become a happier person by the end of this speech, President Tui is going to refund your tuition. See, it worked. So genes. Believe it or not, happiness is in your DNA. I don't want this to be true. I don't want this to be true. I come from sort of a dark, brooding family. And the truth is, I'm kind of that too. See, I'm a 4. Okay? I'm a 4. I've always been a 4, right? And I always wondered to myself, what is it about my character that makes me deficient in being able to be a little bit higher, a little bit better, a little bit happier? Because my life is great. How come I can't enjoy things enough to actually be a happier person? Well, the science shows that a lot of it is in the DNA. How much? The answer is 48%. Now, how did I come up with that? Sounds a little bit precise, right? The answer is that psychologists at the University of Minnesota have this wonderful database of twins. And now, twins are really interesting. Some of them are identical, and some of them are fraternal, and they share certain amounts of DNA, and using the right statistical tools, you can figure out, when you look at twins, if you understand personalities, how much of happiness is genetic and how much of it is environmental. The most interesting thing that the researchers at Minnesota had was a sub-database of 75 pairs of twins, identical twins that were separated at birth, and they were sent adoptively to separate families. Now, this is like a social scientist's dream, right? You say it too loud, and the Obama administration will probably do it by force, right? But it's great when you've got these data. And so the psychologists looked at the data, and they found some very interesting things. They found that almost all of our personalities are more innate than we previously thought. 40% of how you vote is genetic. 40% of how religious you are is genetic. Women are happier, and they've been happier for a long time. I'm going to leave you with a little bit of a mystery that I'm going to ask you to chew on. I'm not going to give you the answer to. Women are happier than men. But the difference has been closing, not because men have been getting happier, but since 1960, women have been getting unhappier. They're not all the way down to the average level of misery of men yet, but that's the direction that they're going. Why? You can think about that yourself. I'm not going to answer that question, but it's pretty interesting when you look at the differences between men and women. Single women are happier than single men. Married women are happier than married men. Widowed women are way happier than widowed men. Told that one to my wife, and she goes, huh, no kidding, right? The only group of women who are unhappier than men is divorced women. And there's an answer to that. There's a reason for that. And the answer is that typically divorced women are left with kids, and it's very stressful to work and raise children by yourself. Families really, really matter to happiness. Hold that thought, because I'm going to come back to it. Now, here's a bonus question, because this is going to help us on the secret to happiness. You know, when I tell you that women are happier than men, I'm not suggesting that any of you guys try to remedy that. Don't let that sink in. But there's an auxiliary question to it that I want to pose to you, because this has a specific answer. What's the average unhappiest age in a man's life? Okay, now, it turns out there's an answer to that, and I know because I've looked at the data, and I've run the numbers, and there are a lot of studies on this, and there's a very distinct unhappiest average age in a man's life. When is it? When is the man unhappiest in his life? Goes down, and then he comes back up, but there's a bottom point on average in the population. The answer is 45. 45. It's the male midlife crisis, but you see it very distinctly in the data. 45, okay? How many of you guys in here are under 45? Under 45, okay. You're on your way down. So what's going on with guys who are 45? That's the question that I have. And I went to a social psychologist, a colleague of mine at Syracuse, and I said, what's the deal? I keep seeing this thing coming up in my data. What's going on? He says, oh, that's simple. And he gave me a bunch of gobbledygook about family relations and dysfunctionality on the something, something, something. And I said, look, you got to put it into English for me. He says, that's when your wife figures out definitively that you're boring, right? I said, fair point. I was, you know, like 45 when I got this information. But I wasn't completely convinced, and I went to the data myself, and it turns out there's another story going on. Here's what's really going on at age 45. It's not all guys. It's only half. It's about half of men that are driving this thing. So when you get a mean, when you get an average, you all know that that can be driven by only part of the population. Okay, so what's going on is half of the guys are just fine, and the other half are really kind of depressed, and they're driving down the population average. So what's going on with those guys? And here's what it looks like. Here's what's really happening. When you're in your 20s, and you're in your 30s, and you're a man, life is actually kind of simple. I mean, you got problems, but doing what you need to do, the objective is pretty simple. You want to be happier, you want to be more successful, you want things to go great, hit the gas, work harder. Get a better job, get a promotion. It's pretty simple. What happens is guys are cruising down the superhighway of their lives, and around age 45, about half say, this is the wrong road. I don't want to be on this superhighway, but I can't stop. I can't turn around because I've got this private school tuition, and I've got this mortgage payment, and I've got this life, and they don't like it. That's what's going on. What do they want? They basically are saying, I want something else. I'm hungry for something else, and I want to be on that little dirt road next to the freeway with a guy on the motorcycle not wearing the helmet, right? That's what I want. So who is that guy? Now, I'm going to tell you how to be the guy on the motorcycle, and it's a lesson not just for men, it's a lesson for women too, it's a lesson for all of us, because this is one of the great secrets to happiness, is how to be the guy on the dirt road. But I have to wait for 10 minutes because I got to tell you some other stuff first. So hold that thought. But I got lucky because I'm the guy in the dirt road. But it was pure dumb luck. Let me tell you the story. When I was 19, I dropped out of college. Or I got kicked out, you know, splitting hairs here. And I went on the road as a musician, because that's what I always wanted to do. I was a French horn player. And, you know, I toured literally all 50 states, playing chamber music, driving all night. I once drove all night, 2 days, 52 hours to be exact, from Baltimore to San Francisco with four other guys to do some gigs. It seemed like a good idea. It's what you do when you're 19 and 20 years old. And I wound up ultimately in the Barcelona Symphony, playing French horn in the Barcelona Symphony for a bunch of years. It's where I married my wife 22 years ago. And in Barcelona, I looked around and I thought, this isn't what I want to do. How did I know that? Because I was working with a lot of guys who were way older than me, and they weren't happy. And I said, I don't want to be them. I don't want to be them. So I got to do something different right now. So I called up my dad. I'm living in Barcelona, and I called up my dad. My dad's in Seattle, right? And I say, Dad, I got big news. I'm gonna change career. I'm gonna quit. I'm gonna go back to college. Maybe I'll study literature or math or economics. I don't know. Music theory. But it's gonna be great. I'm gonna live by my wits. Truly, I'm gonna be an intellectual. My dad was a math professor. I said, Dad, I'm gonna be like you. I thought he was gonna be thrilled. He says, what are you talking about? You started a family. You can't do that. It's irresponsible. You can't just quit. You're making a living. Why? And I was ready. I said, because Dad, I'm not happy. Right? There's this long silence on the line. And he says, what makes you so special? You got a dad like that? Huh. But I did find the right path. And I'm going to tell you what I found by accident. Now that I am a little bit past 45, and I'm going to tell you how you can find it too. But I want to go on to the next big source of happiness, which is beyond genes, beyond that 48%. And that's big events in your life. This is what you're really concerned about. When you want to be happier, you think about doing some big single thing that's going to make you happier, or you're going to avoid some really bad thing that's going to make you unhappy. That's how humans are wired, right? If I only can finish my degree, then I'll be happy. If I only can get a really good job as a lawyer, then I'll be happy. If I only can convince that girl to marry me, then I'll be happy. And if only I don't get sick, then I won't be unhappy. If only I don't have a bad accident, then I won't be unhappy. That's how we're wired. We're goal-oriented creatures. And so we think about the big thing. The question is, how much does any big thing at any particular time, how much of your happiness does it control? And the answer is a ton, 40%. 40% of your happiness are circumstances from current events in your life, big and small, for good or for ill. So you should spend all your time on that stuff. That's not right. Turns out you shouldn't. Why not? Because number one, most of what you do to attain big things or to avoid big bad things doesn't work. And number two, the big things don't last. How long does weather affect your happiness? I know lots of people who moved to California or Florida for the weather. Sorry, I don't mean, I'm gonna cast aspersions on the faculty here, but how long does great weather affect your happiness? We got the data. The answer is 6 months. 6 months and then you're back into your rut, right? How about if you double your income? How long? 3 months. Right? The big things don't matter. Now, there's a great study at the University of Michigan. It's actually an old study. It's from the late 1970s, but it's still the gold standard in what we know about this. This is a study that looked at paraplegics and lottery winners. Perhaps you've heard about this study. And the paraplegics, basically what they found was that 6 months after people had an accident where they lost control of their legs, their happiness was almost all the way back to where it was the day before their accident. Extraordinary. People are so durable. Thank God. It's amazing. Now, they wish they could walk because that's sensible, but our happiness comes back to where we are because it's our set point, basically. Now, what else do we know? We know that the lottery winners don't do so great, right? Now, if you ever play that game where you go around the room to break the ice with people you don't know, and you say, if I hit the lottery, what would I do? Right? Everybody goes around. And it's always the same things. I would write that book I've always wanted to write. I would get a job I really love even if it doesn't pay anything. I would go live closer to my family. When guys are trying to impress girls, you know what they say? They say, I'd start a foundation. Right? No, you wouldn't. So here's what guys never say. Here, men and women never say. They never say this. If I hit the lottery, you know what I'd do? Oh, man. It'd be so great. I'd start by buying a bunch of junk I don't want and need. That gives me no satisfaction. Then I think I'd get into an ill-fated romantic relationship with somebody who doesn't love me. And then, what I'd do? I'd start a bad alcoholic spiral. That's what happens. It turns out that's what happens. It's terrible. You've heard the stories about lottery winners, and they're true. The question is, why? Why does that happen? And that's where it gets interesting. We know why. The answer is not that suddenly they have access to all this stuff and it ruins their lives. The answer is because they're looking. They do these bad things because they're looking for something they can't find. Lottery winners, 6 months after they win, are permanently slightly less happy than they were the day before they bought the ticket. The best thing that can happen, now I know you can't relate to this because none of you like bought a bunch of scratch-offs on the way to this convocation speech, but recall, this state preys on poor people to buy lottery tickets. The government of this state and most states is inducing poor people to do this. So the stakes on this morally are really high. Okay, so why? Why are they unhappier? The answer is because, and in 6 months, all the thrill of having the money wears off. They don't enjoy buying the stuff. There's nothing that great about having another car or a bigger house. What happens, though, is that all the little joys in their life have been muted, have been kind of blown out. They've sort of had their circuits blown. The relationships with their old friends, they're gone. Their new friends aren't that great. They don't enjoy watching TV or hanging out or hobbies or going to mass. They don't enjoy it anymore. It turns out that after this big event occurs that they didn't earn, and that's important, going to come back to that, that they didn't earn, blows the circuits, and they're never happy again. That's why they do the bad things, because they're in search of something that will give their lives full flavor again. It's a curse. Never, never take anything you didn't earn, and don't look for the big event. That's the bottom line. That's what the research says. Sorry about the 40%. Because if you work for it the way most people do, you're not going to get it. Now, I said 48%, and then I said 40%, and if you're doing the math, you got 12% left. But here's the good news. We know how you can get that 12% starting now, and doing the things that will give you the 12% will also give you better luck on the 40%. Because what you need to get good luck and avoid bad luck is the right life. That's what you need. You need to behave the right way and be in the right position to have good things happen to you. You need to be positioned properly. And that will also guaranteed give you the last 12%. Now, when I first started looking at the data, I said, 12%, does it matter? Maybe I shouldn't even study this. If it's only 12% I can directly control. But that's wrong. If only 12% of your happiness is under your direct control, you better get it right. Don't screw it up. If somebody told you you had 1 year left to live, what would you do? Waste it? No. You'd live every moment to the fullest. And that's what you need to do with the 12% of your happiness, which gives you good luck to boot. So here's the question, and here's going to be the solution to the happiness problem. What are the elements of the lives of the happiest people in our country? Right? And we know the answer. This is the result of 200 refereed academic journal articles and books. I've read them so you don't have to. This is something that you can take to the bank. There are four things. Now, I'm going to start by something actually that's not on the list, because you sort of think it is, but it's not. And that's money, right? Okay, I know that your mother told you and your priest told you that money doesn't buy happiness. But if you're like me, you're saying, well, let me figure that one out for myself, right? Let me figure that one out for myself. Let me just see if money buys happiness. Actually, let's cut to the chase and look at the data. What do the data say? Let's look at the United States going back to 1972 till the present. What's happened to the average purchasing power in the United States? The answer is it's grown by 150%. The average American is 150% richer in real purchasing power terms than in the early 1970s, and that's true for every group in society. Now, the rich have gotten richer faster than the poor have gotten richer, but everybody is actually more prosperous than they were in the early 1970s. So how much happier are we? The answer is, we're not. We've gone from 1972 from 33% of the population being very happy to 31% of the population being very happy today, and every study backs that up. It's completely static. It's flatlined. If you look at how people who get richer, what happens in their lives is, as they're relieved of material poverty, if they're moved through true indigence, they get happier because pressure is relieved. And incidentally, this has policy prescriptions to it. We can and should not just tolerate, but celebrate a real safety net for the most indigent citizens, because you can lift them from misery. You can actually buy happiness in a strange and paradoxical way. But once you get above subsistence, it's all gone. Families that are lower middle class or above, doesn't matter how rich they get, they will never have any more happiness that charts back to that money ever again. This is research that comes from Daniel Kahneman, who's the only non-economist ever to win the Nobel Prize in economics. He's a psychologist at Princeton, does wonderful work on this. But the bottom line is this: don't look for money if you're trying to find happiness. Your mother was right. You need to look for four things. You need to invest in four things: faith, family, friends, and work. That's all that matters. That's it. Everything else is instrumental. Your money, your health, your freedom, it's all instrumental. The intrinsic things that will bring you happiness are faith, family, friends, and work. Now, believe it or not, I'm not going to spend very much time on faith, family, and friends, because I want to talk about work. I'm just going to summarize it this way. Faith, family, and friends. You want to know how to get it? Have a bunch of kids and move to Ave Maria. Congratulations. But I want to really talk about work, because work is what we don't typically think of as something that's this joy-inducing phenomenon in our lives. You know, we think of work as drudgery. We think of work as something that brings, as economists call it, disutility. Money brings utility, work brings disutility. That's exactly wrong. You want to know what's really wrong with economics? Is we got it backwards. Money brings you little to nothing if you're middle class or above, and work is where it's at. What percentage of Americans like or love their jobs? What percentage of Americans are either satisfied or very satisfied with their work? The answer is 89%. I bet you thought you were going to say, I was going to say 21%. 89% of Americans are either satisfied or very satisfied with their jobs. Now, it doesn't matter if you have a college degree or you don't. It doesn't matter if you're above average income or below average income. It doesn't matter if you're white or you're black. It doesn't matter if you're Catholic or Protestant. 89% of Americans in all of those groups like or love their jobs. This is extraordinary by world standards. There's no other country in which I've seen the data where it comes remotely close to this. What a blessing. And I'm married to a European. She says, Americans live to work, but we work to live. Actually, living and working are like all part of breathing. Breathing in and breathing out, if you do it right. The person who's going to make your sandwich tomorrow loves her job. The person who's delivering your mail today loves his job. And you're going to love your jobs too, if you take them seriously and you sanctify them in the right way. That's what I want to spend the rest of my time on now, because it's so important. There's nothing better than that a man should rejoice in his own works. Ecclesiastes 3:22. If you look at people and why they love their work, you got to ask yourself this. Why? What is the secret for most people? And incidentally, you know the people who are most unhappy in their jobs? It's those guys at 45. So let's get back to the guy who's stuck on the road going someplace he doesn't want to go and he's depressed. What's going on with him? What is it that he wants? What is it that most of us have, the other half of guys, the rest of the population, and most of you, probably all of you, are going to have? It's very simple. It's called earned success. Earned success is the belief that you're creating value with your life and creating value in the lives of other people, that you're serving to create value and you're serving others. Earned success is so powerful that if you take two people who are precisely the same, this is from data from the University of Chicago, the General Social Survey, two people precisely the same age, sex, race, religion, even the same level of education, and they both feel that they have earned their success in life. Nothing to do with money, because one earns 8 times more than the other per year. They will be equally likely to say that they're very happy about their lives. Money doesn't buy happiness. Earned success brings happiness. It's the secret. If you can sanctify your life and serve others. Now, here's how I learned this. I learned that from a composer. I found it in the data, but I learned it from a composer when I was still a musician. When I was a musician, my favorite composer was the same favorite composer of a lot of you who follow classical music. It was Johann Sebastian Bach. What a great composer. Cantatas for chorus and orchestra for every Sunday in the lectionary fell off his pen. It's incredible. How did he do it? He was the master of the high Baroque, and he had 20 children. That's productive, right? Bach, the greatest. He was asked, why do you write music? Now, what's a composer going to say? It's a living. I got to pay the rent. It's what I'm good at. I like music. No, you know what Bach said? I write music for a simple reason: the glory of God and the enjoyment of man. Now, Bach, the most important thing in Bach's life was his faith. He was a very serious Christian. He was a Lutheran. He was almost there. And Bach was simply paraphrasing Luke 10:27. You'll look that up later. But those are the things that you need to do. You need to glorify God and serve others in your work. That's what earned success is all about. That's what put me on the trail. I said when I was a musician, if I can say that at some point in my career in my life, then I'll be happy. And it's right. It's completely right. It's completely right. You know the weirdest thing ever? I'm working right now. It's crazy. I get paid to talk to people about how to have a happier life. I get to run an institution full of geniuses that are doing work to save their country. It's incredible. What a pleasure. What a privilege. I feel like I'm serving God and I'm serving men and women. I feel like I'm doing this for the glory of God and the enjoyment of man. And that's why I think I'm happier than I was when I was still playing the French horn. What do we need as a country for earned success? Because this is not simply an economic alternative. This is a moral imperative. If you believe that you deserve to be happy, then you also believe axiomatically as Catholics that other people deserve to be happy too. And therefore, you need to create a system in which they can be happy. So what are you going to do so more people can earn their success? What does our country need? The first thing is what I just said. We need a system. We need a system that matches people's skills with their passions. We need a system that celebrates hard work and personal responsibility. We need a system in which people can keep the rewards of the things that they do right. We need a system in which when people fail, they feel the failure so that they can do better next time. Not catastrophically necessarily, but where we don't blunt the disadvantages all the time in life and make people learn their helplessness. And here's the great news. That system exists. That system exists. It's called the free enterprise system. It's the greatest blessing that economics has ever accidentally produced. Consider this. Consider this. You think a lot about poor people, I know. This is a wonderfully socially conscious campus. I'm so proud to be part of this. President Tui, paradoxically, was Mother Teresa's lawyer. And he tells me that she loved suing people, so. But a concern for the poor is in your DNA. Think about what's happened to the poor since 1970. When I was a kid, when I was a little kid in 1970, what were the poor? There were pictures in National Geographic. There were malnourished children with flies on their faces who were dying of starvation, and nobody could do anything about it. Today, what's the third world? There are a lot of poor people, and I believe, as you do, as St. Matthew did, that as you did for the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you do for me. But think of the difference between 1970 and today. Do you know what the change has been in the percentage of the world's population living on a dollar a day or less? The percentage of the world's population living in absolute starvation poverty, the change from 1970 to today, has been a decline of 80%. An 80% decline in the world's worst, in the percentage of the world's worst poverty. You gotta have an explanation because there's never been an anti-poverty achievement like that in the history of mankind. We should read about it in the paper. We should be popping champagne corks. At least we should have an explanation. So what is it? Is it the United Nations? Is it the International Monetary Fund? Is it the World Bank? Is it global socialism? Is it central planning? No, 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 no. It's five things: globalization, free trade, rule of law, entrepreneurship, and property rights. It is the American free enterprise system that started to spread around the world after 1970 that has literally lifted billions of people out of poverty. Free enterprise did that. You did that. You built that. And you didn't even know it. It's incredible. See, working for charity is important for our souls, but we have to be able to help people also while we sleep. We can't get to the billions one by one. We need a system to do that. We need a blessed system. We need a gift from God that we can spread, and we have it. The free enterprise system does that. Somebody is literally not going to bed hungry in sub-Saharan Africa tonight because of the stuff that you fight for and the life that you live and the business that you will conduct and the wonderful things you're going to do with your career in the free enterprise system, and you're not even going to know it. 662 million Chinese in the People's Republic of China have been pulled out of absolute starvation level poverty since 1980 because of free trade. We give it a bad rap all the time, but if you love the least of these, our brothers and sisters, you must fight for the system. You might want to make it better. That's good. But you got to fight for the system that actually will lift people out of poverty like that. There's no other miracle like it that we've ever seen. You got to have a system. That's the first thing we need for more earned success for more people. But we need faith, too. We need faith, too, because a lot of the world doesn't know, but you and I know, that faith and work go together. They just do. St. Jose Maria Escrivá, the founder of Opus Dei, taught us, there is no human undertaking which cannot be sanctified. Is your work a prayer? Is your prayer a kind of special work? If the answer is yes, you're on the right path, and not just on the right path for your own happiness and the own satisfaction of your career, but to create earned success in the life of others. Here's my bottom line. The keys to your happiness are faith, family, friends, and work. If you want to enrich your lives and the lives of others, you must work for those things and encourage them, and work for a culture that will make those things easier and more possible. Here's the best part. You have to have institutions that can bring these things, and I know of no better institution that does it than this university. That's why I'm here. I didn't go here. I mean, I barely went to college at all, as you heard. But if I had, I'd want to go someplace that in every class, in every paper you write, in every word you learn, makes the world a better place through faith, family, friends, and work. I know you're working for it, but you need to be a warrior for it. Because as you leave tonight, and as you go forward through this year, and as you proceed through the rest of your life, you're going to be able to bring these values to others. And when you do, you've brought the secret to happiness to them too. So for doing that, for improving my country, for making my life better, God bless you and thank you.